Hello, this is Thomas solving the group theory exercise sheets. Here we got exercise 6F of problem set 1, and we're going to solve a funny result, namely that all four element groups can be divided into two distinct algebraic structures. So how do we tackle that kind of thing? The first reaction would be to construct multiplication tables because we can read a lot of them. In fact, we can read out of them these two different algebraic structures. So let's get started. We start by writing the most general multiplication table we can imagine. We use our unspecific four elements A, B, C, and E. And the first thing we know about groups is there must be an identity element. So let's define E to be the identity element, and then we can fill out the first row and first column easily. Now the first question emerging is, what comes right here? What is A times A? We have several different choices. In fact, we have two different choices right here. First choice is, of course, A times A equal to E. Second choice is A times A equal to B. Why are there only these two choices? Okay, let's check the other two. What happens if we put A times A equal to A? Well, that would imply A being the identity element, and we already got that covered for E. What happens if we take A times A equal to C? If A times A equal to C, then it wouldn't be any different to A times A equal to B, because we could simply relabel B and C, and we would recover that multiplication table we were about to write over here. So, in fact, we've got only two different choices for A times A. Let's start by constructing the multiplication table for A times A equal to E. Okay, we copy everything we've got from over here, and we got here E. Next question would be, what can we write over here? What is the composition of B and A? So we got two different choices. First choice is A times B is equal to C. Other choice would be A times B equal to B. Why can't A times B equal to B? Because then it would imply B being the identity element. And we're left with the remaining choice, A times B equal to C. The other two choices are already taken because of the rearrangement theorem. I will quickly explain what is the rearrangement theorem. The arrangement theorem is crucial for this proof, so I can quickly explain it. Let's say we have a multiplication table right here, and the rearrangement theorem says that in every row or in every column, every single element of the group is repeated exactly once and only once. So we can't write A over here because we already wrote A over here. With the same logic, we can deduce that here the only possible value to write is B. We can mirror those arguments and write down the same two letters over here. Now we have a question. What is B times B? B times B can have two different choices again. One choice, B squared equal E, other choice, B squared equal A. Both choices are legitimate choices. Let's start by filling out the multiplication table for B squared equal E. We have E, A, B, C. I just quickly copy that from the left over here. Here we got E, B, C, B, and here we have E. Again, we use our rearrangement theorem. We see that the only letter missing here is A, and the only letter missing here is A. And we can check E is it's correct. That is one possible multiplication table for a four-element group. The other possible multiplication table for a four-element group we can write down here. A, B, C, E, A, B, C. A. Here we say it's... I'll write that again over here. E, A, B, C, E, A, B, C. So here E, then C, B, C, B, and then here we've got A. And then we use the rearrangement theorem again, just as we did right here, to obtain E, E, A. Okay, now we've got that branch covered, and we tackle the other one. E, A, B, C, E, A, B, C. We've got that first row and first column. And we have B over here. What can we write here? With the same argument we did below, it's not possible to write E. So we have to write C, then we have E here, we have C and E. Here we have again two different choices, A and E. A would be impossible because then we would have had A times A equal to B and B times B equal to A. So either A or B must be the identity element. And that can't be. So we have to put E over here and then we fill out the rest with the rearrangement theorem. We have A, A and B over here. From the point we have reached right now, it seems as if we've got three different structures for multiplication table. Well, but this is not true. We can see over here we have on the diagonal two different elements, each repeated by two times. Here we have the same. So we can guess, well, what happens if we rearrange those elements, can we obtain that same multiplication table? And yes, that's true. We can come from here to here by rearranging to E, B, A, and C. And we can do that because of the rearrangement theorem. Okay, now we are left with two different possible multiplication tables, which we have to find examples for. In the first one, we already encountered that being C to V in a previous exercise. The other one we recognize as C4. And this is true, because here we see that this is abelian, and this is abelian and cyclic. So, here in this multiplication table, we see that all group elements can be obtained by taking successive products. So here we have an abelian and cyclic four element group, and here we have an abelian four element group. That's our result. Thank you for watching. I hope you understood my explanations. See you next time.